I'm very happy to see that so many of you have joined my defense today, both in person and online. So the topic of my doctoral thesis is protected lignin biorefining, fundamental insights on lignin reactivity. The work I will present today is included in these 5 papers, where 4 of them are published. And some updates of the papers after I published the thesis is that the paper number 5 is now accepted. And for paper number 3, we have now submitted revisions. And I am the first author of all the papers. And in paper 5, we are 2 persons sharing the first authorship. The challenge to have today is to take care of the environment and use the resources on Earth in a sustainable way. We often hear that we have a linear economy models, where in many cases, fossil resources are used as raw material. And towards a more sustainable society, we're more looking into circular economy models, where the material from a product's end cycles can be used as a start material for a new product's life cycle. And the question is, can biomass replace the crude oil in these circular economy models? Biomass is a renewable resource on Earth and has the potential to be an alternative to fossil-based resources. And we need to find ways to utilize the biomass in such a way and try to retrieve components from the biomass that are suitable to be these alternatives to the fossil-based raw materials. In 2015, the United Nations released 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And this was aimed to improve the society in several ways. And within this work, there are 3 goals that are especially addressed by goal number 9, industry, innovation, and infrastructure. Number 12, responsible consumption and production. And goal number 13, climate action. And this by the development of new process concepts which aim to improve the way how we can retrieve biomass with high quality, component from the biomass with high quality that might be suitable for the future bio-based materials. And this by using green chemicals and with the aim to increase the carbon dioxide emissions. And this by use unutilized biomass that are today traditionally burnt, generating biogenic carbon dioxide. So the outline of today's presentation is first I will give an introduction and background to the topic. And this will be followed by a development of a protective extraction method from paper 1, tailoring on chemical properties using chemometrics, a refined extraction method using a shorter concept, analytical techniques and methods for lignin, and lignin for bio-based applications. So the biomass that has been in focus within this work is wood. And wood comprises of fibers, and within the fiber there are different cell wall layers by the middle lamella, primary wall, and secondary cell walls. And the middle lamella connect the fiber together in a network. And within the cell wall layers, we have the cellulose fibrils that are surrounded by lignin and hemicellulose. And dependent on what species we look at, the ratio of the 3 main polymers in biomass, namely the cellulose, lignin, and hemicellulose, differs, where cellulose is usually between 40 to 45%, lignin 20 to 30%, and hemicellulose 25 to 30%. And the largest concentration of lignin can be found in the middle lamella. However, largest quantity is found in the secondary cell wall due to the relatively large volume of these cell wall layers. And now we will look more into lignin. And in the lignin polymerization, there are radical coupling that occur, here illustrating a conifer alcohol which is the main monolignol in softwood such as spruce. By an oxidation, phenoxy radicals are created, and there are, you can see here, different resonance forms that could be formed from this oxidation. And these are connected to each other or to the growing lignin polymer in a combinatorial way. And here we have some examples on some dimers where we have a coupling by different radicals, where the most abundant interunit linkages is in lignin is the beta-O4 interunit linkages, which we have about 60% of in spruce and 80% of in birch. The craft process is the largest pulping process today that produces pulp in large scale. However, the lignin that is obtained from the black liquor has an altered and complex structure. Another process that doesn't produce that large quantity of pulp is the sulfite process. And both these processes are sulfur-based processes. To be an answer to a non-sulfur-based process, the organosolv process was developed. And this is a sulfur-free process where the most common organosolv process is the alcell process, where an aqueous ethanol solvent with or without sulfuric acid as a catalyst is used to extract the lignin. And this is performed in a temperature between 160 and 220 degrees in a batch cook extraction. And there are some reactions in the organosolv process that used to occur. First, we have the formation of the mesylic cation, and this is due to the acidic conditions. And by this formation, there are some reactions that are prone to occur, such as condensation reactions. And these are unwanted since the carbon-carbon bonds are hard to cleave. And also, this could also cause solubility problems in the extraction. And here we have some examples of intra- and intermolecular condensations, such as the intermolecular condensation of alpha 5, the intermolecular condensation of alpha 5, a 5-5 connection, which actually have a different pathway by homolytical cleavage of the beta 4 interunit linkages, and some intermolecular condensation of alpha 6. Other reaction that used to occur is the depolymerization with the formation of Heber's ketone. But we can also have some capping reaction. Here illustrating from an alcell cook when we have ethanol in the cooking liquor. And then we have some eterification on this reactive mesylic cation from the ethanol. And this prevents further reaction on this position. And there are some strategies that people have come up with. How can we protect the lignin structure? Because as I shown in the previous slide, this will give an altered and complex structure of the lignin, and you have this in a mixture. So towards valorization of lignin, there are different strategies that can be considered, such as physical protection and chemical protection strategies. And here is an example of a physical protection strategy by the flow through extraction. And this is based on a continuous extraction where you have the biomass in the cell and you continuously add new solvent to the cell and continuously release solvent from the cell that has cooled the condenser to try to prevent this kind of reactions. And they can see that you have few condensation and high degree of beta-O4 interunit linkages. And why we talk about the beta-O4 is, well, it's the most common interunit linkage in lignin, but also an ether bond in these linkages, which are quite easily cleaved during the extraction. And for the chemical protection, the principle is to add a protective group to it and to deactivate functional groups, and thereby prevent condensation and degradation reactions. And here is an example where they use acetylization to prevent this reaction to occur. But are there any limitations with this kind of protection strategies? We have, from the flow-through extraction, we use a high consumption of solvent. And for the chemical protection, in many cases, toxic chemicals and additives are used, which is not good and can also complicate the recovery of the chemicals. So there are some environmental concerns and technical feasibility issues related to these protective strategies. The aim of this thesis was to explore a biorefinery concept for extraction of lignin, adopting a physical protection strategy using green solvents. And some specific consideration for the developed process was that less solvent should be used compared to the flow through extraction. And also all the different streams should be considered. And the process should be potentially circular. And we were not supposed to use any protective additives. And also fundamental understanding of the process is included by robust analytical method development and by the use of chemometric studies. So in paper one, the development of a consolidated biorefinery concept was investigated by a two-step extraction method where we selectively extract the hemicellulose and lignin in a two-step extraction procedure. So in the first step, we have a hot water extraction, a batch extraction for 2 hours, when the main part of the hemicellulose was extracted. And this was followed by an organosolv lignin extraction using ethanol and water together with a catalytic amount of sulfuric acid to extract the lignin. And how did we protect the lignin structure then? Well, we used a cyclic extraction concept in the lignin extraction. And this means that every 5 minutes, only a part of the extract was replaced by a new solvent in the extraction cell. And we performed this in 15 cycles. And we can see that the lignin we obtained had a high content of beta-4 interunit linkages. It has a preserved structure by that and also a few condensations. And here is an HSQC NMR spectra that we use for both qualitative and semi-quantitative analysis of the lignin. And as can be seen here, we have an heterification on the alpha position, as is expected since we used ethanol in the extraction liquor. And this given a shift of the beta-4 alpha signal in the NMR spectra. We can also see that our lignin was quite pure, where we have no visible signals in the anomeric region of carbohydrates. And this region is often used to check the purity if we have carbohydrates in our lignin, since there are no overlapping with other lignin signals in the spectra here. And to really try to understand how this cyclic extraction concept worked and how it affected the lignin property. Trend study was performed where the lignin was studied for every cycle and collected separately. And this graph showed the trend of the beta-4 and beta-5 interunit linkage content, where we can see that from cycle 3, approximately 4, we have a quite stable level of beta-4 and beta-5. And we can also see that the levels are lower in the first cycle, and this might be an effect of the hot water extraction that was performed in a batch cook at 160 degrees. And then we pulled this together to an integrated method where we extracted 50 cycles in a row. And then we can also see that the levels are still in the range of what they was when we collected the cycles separately, the lignin separately. And then we were also looking at the hydroxyl functionality using phosphorus NMR. And here we compared the cyclic extraction method using the integrated, where we collect the 50 cycles together, with a 2-hour batch method. And in this reference, the 2-hour batch method, we used the exactly same protocol except for the cycles. So it was also a hot water extraction followed by the organosolv extraction. And we can see that we have higher content of aliphatic hydroxyls in the cyclic extracted lignin which also might indicate that we have less side reactions on the lignin molecules. And in a similar manner, the trends in the lignin yields was investigated using two different acid concentrations, where each cycle was collected separately. And we can see that approximately 70% of the extracted lignin was extracted in the first cycles. And if we compare the reference sample with the cyclic extracted lignin, we can look at the B2O4 content, where it was significantly higher for the cyclic extracted lignin by 30, and in the reference it was 7. And to have a B2O4 content of 7 is very common in also in traditional organosolv extractions, and often a value that is often reported. And if we look at the yield, we can see that there is not a huge difference between the yields. They are in the similar range. And what is interesting here is that the effective extracting time using the cyclic extraction method was 1 hour and 15 minutes. And for the reference sample, it was 2 hours. So we could obtain a lignin with more preserved structure in a similar yield, but in a shorter time by using the cyclic extraction method. And moving from this, we wanted to further understand this method, how the different factors, how the different conditions we used in the extraction actually affected the different properties of lignin. And this was performed using a multivariate approach by the design of experiment, where the investigated factors were the temperature, acid concentration, and ethanol water ratio. And the investigated properties was the yield, B2O4, hydroxyl functionalities, and molecular weight and dispersity. So the purpose of this was to investigate the factor dependence on the lignin properties. And why we use this approach, instead of evaluating one factor at a time, is that we could miss other effects than linear effects, since in this case, we use a quadratic design, including both linear effects, quadratic effects, and interaction effects. By not including all these effects, it might be possible that we miss some of the important effects the factor have on the lignin properties. So the selected design was the Box-Behnken design, and the temperature was investigated between 110 and 170 degrees, acid concentration between 0.5 to 2.5 weight percent, and ethanol water ratio 60 to 80 ethanol volume. And the model was tuned to reduce the noise. And here is an illustration of the influence of the significant cap factors for the yield, beta-4, aliphatic hydroxyls, and aromatic hydroxyls. And for the yield, we have only significant linear effects. But we can see for the other properties included here that we have more than linear effects. We have both quadratic and interaction effects. And I can tell that in this graph, a positive effect can be shown by a positive value here, meaning that the yield will increase by increasing the temperature. And the other graphs can be interpreted in a similar manner. So then we were thinking, could it be possible by using this information to tailoring the lignin properties? And the data was fit by multiple linear regression, and we here illustrated in the response surface plots, now for the beta-4 content. And we also did the same for the other properties. And we created the library of lignin with different functionalities and properties. So within this experimental domain and inside the boundaries of what we used in this study, since we have significant models, we can predict what kind of responses we will get by using different value of the factors by the ethanol water ratio, acid concentration, and temperature. And then we were thinking, could we refine this method? Could we use a shorter extraction method? So far, we talked about this two-step method in paper one and two. But then we wanted to see, could we use the one-step method instead by excluding the hot water extraction? And this we could also combine with what we learned from the previous studies, that we use less number of cycles, where we saw in paper one that 70% of the lignin is extracted in the first four cycles. So why go with 15 if we don't need that many cycles? And also to use the optimized conditions that we could see from the design of experiment study in paper number two. And that was, now we also focus on the B2O4 content, and we could see that the optimized conditions from paper two was using 140 degrees and 1.5 weight percent of acid and 70 to 30 volume ethanol and water in the suction solvent. And here we have the HSQC NMR spectra for spruce using 9 cycles instead of 15. And we can see that we have dibenzo dioxazine, and this interunit linkages is often cleaved very early in the extraction, but here we had it preserved. And if we compare this refined method, calling one-step method with a two-step method and a benchmark, we can see by using 9 cycles at 140 degrees, if we compare the two-step and one-step, we have a significantly higher amount of B2O4 interunit linkages by 57 instead of 40 for the two-step method. And if we also look at the aliphatic hydrosyl content, we also had an increase there by 4.11 instead of 3.58. So by using a shorter concept, we could preserve the lignin structure even better. And then we wanted to investigate the universality of the process by try out a different species. And then we use birds as a representative for the hardwood species. And even here, we could see that the concept works similarly for hardwoods as for softwood by the spruce. By high preservance of the beta-4 content, where we have near theoretical values for the beta-4 content for both wood species. And if we look at the yield and compare it between the two-step and one-step extraction method, we could see that we actually increased the yield of extracted lignin. Here we compare 9 cycle 140 with the two-step using 15 cycles 140. And even with fewer cycles, we have a higher value of the yield by 36 instead of 30. And we also check the repeatability of the process, where we have a quite low standard deviation using 3 replicates. And the color of the lignin is similar to the color of wood. And here we also have some example of the color from some more technical lignin by the organosolv and the craft lignin. And now that we have this lignin with quite preserved properties, we wanted to further investigate and study it. And this by a study about lignin populations, where we combined NMR with MALDI-TOF MS and DFT. So first, we synthesize the lignin and analyze it by MALDI-TOF MS and also NMR. And from the MS spectra, we could identify clusters with mass increments corresponding to beta-4, beta-5, and beta-beta, together with conoferyl alcohol differences. We can also identify an endwise polymerization and emerge of branching points by the nucleophilic addition of conoferyl alcohol to the quinone methyl. That could be both alpha 4 or alpha gamma. The lignin retrieved by the two-step extraction method was also analyzed by the Malditov MS. And here we can also identify clusters and some regularity in the repeating units with a mass difference of 338. And this mass difference should be corresponding to a dimeric repeating unit that has lots of small molecules and also has some intramolecular condensations. So we look into this, and by starting with a native-like lignin model by a beta-4 hexamer, then we have these alternate condensations that could occur during the organosolv extraction. And then from the MALDI events, some reaction could occur, which then could form this dimeric unit of 338 Dalton. And here is a tentative structure that shows an example how this structure could look like. And towards more applications, we were investigating the correlation between the molecular structure of lignin and characteristics of its nanoparticles. And this by the morphology, dispersity, surface characteristics, and sizes of the nanoparticles. And what we could conclude from this study is that dependent on the lignin structure, the nanoparticles will also be changed according to that. So the nanoparticles will have different properties dependent on the actual molecular structure of the lignin. So in this project, a new biorefinery concept was developed, which could preserve the lignin structure. And this lignin is odorless with a bright color and have tailorable features. And this was performed by using chemometrics. And this also shown to be a universal process with a high repeatability. And by using robust characterizations, we could reveal some populations with regular structure within the lignin sample. I want to acknowledge Knut and Alice Wallenberg from DASEN for funding the research. I also want to acknowledge my co-authors for very nice collaborations. Also, my main supervisor, Professor Martin Lawoko, and my two co-supervisors, Professor Åsa Emmer and Dr. Olena Sevesianova. Thank you very much.